Our next session is titled The Law and Strategy of Cyber Conflict. And I think it's important, I like that title, I think it's important to look at law and strategy together. It's more to do so in part because understanding what cyber conflict might look like and how states and other actors will use cyber tools, I think is important in understanding how law in this area is likely to develop. It's also important because if we want law to constrain, no legal regime is likely to survive if it isn't sensitive to the strategic realities of cyber conflict, cyber tools. So I'm delighted to have this lineup of four speakers. I think it's appropriate that we have two lawyers and two non-lawyers on this panel. Rather than introducing them all up front, let me introduce them in turn as I introduce the different subtopics of this. I want to turn first to Professor Ryan Goodman of NYU Law School to talk about jus ad bellum and threshold issues. I think one way of looking at this issue is that international law with regard to protection of states and initiation of conflict draws certain traditional thresholds. We have an idea of sovereignty that protects states. The UN Charter talks about a prohibition on the use or threat of force by a state against another state. Self-defense under Article 51 of the UN Charter is triggered by an armed attack. And all of these various thresholds need some interpretation in the cyber world. What does sovereignty mean with regard to cyber attacks? What kind of cyber attacks might constitute a use of force or an armed attack? And so let me first turn to Professor Goodman to get us started on that discussion.
Thanks so much, Matt. So I thought I would just start my remarks with two caveats. The first is that I'm actually quite new to cyber. I'm quite familiar with the laws of war, use of force, jus ad bellum, but cyber is somewhat unfamiliar territory to me, and maybe that also has some of its benefits in that I come with a fresh mind to some of these issues. A second caveat is that I prepared my remarks with one of my doctoral students, Nimrod Karin, and he, in a sense, is a co-author of these remarks, and we're working on this together. So anything interesting I say should be ascribed to him, and anything wrong I say should be ascribed to me. So I do want to begin actually where Matt left off, which is what he referred to as the thresholds. I might refer to it as the baseline legal rules. And one general assumption that the baseline legal rules apply to cyber as much as they apply to kinetic force. In other words, the legal system is unified or unitary. And part of what I'll raise are questions about whether or not that's a good thing, or even if it's an inevitable thing, what the kinds of concerns are that come up because of that. But the idea is that cyber attacks and cyber weaponry can be thought of in similar terms to kinetic attacks and kinetic weaponry, defined in part by whether or not the attack results in foreseeable death, injury, or physical damage. One caution here is that some of the problems that I might identify when talking about cyber are actually problems that are already debated and talked about generically with respect to the use of force regime, so that we shouldn't fail to understand that, that it's in some sense not unique to cyber, and these arguments and debates are already taking place elsewhere. And part of that understanding means I'm going to try to emphasize when my comments or remarks are very specific to cyber, when cyber produces potentially unique concerns, problems, or opportunities. So what are the basic baseline rules or the thresholds, as Matt referred to them, for the use of force? The UN Charter and apparently customary international law prohibits all uses of force except in self-defense. And then if a state is going to act in self-defense, it can only do so in response to an armed attack. And that's the threshold of a certain level of severity in the use of force. But the armed attack could either, the state has the right to use self-defense if the armed attack has occurred, or in anticipation of an armed attack, otherwise thought of as anticipatory self-defense. The way I usually think of it is for Pearl Harbor, imagine if the United States knew that the Japanese aircraft carriers were coming over, you don't have to wait to absorb the first hit, you can take them out. That's anticipatory self-defense for an imminent threat of an armed attack. The US position is different from that baseline in two respects that I think are important. First, the United States opposes what I just described as the threshold. The United States government's position is not that we need to wait for a level of an armed attack to be able to respond in kind with the use of force, but rather can just be tit for tat. If an adversary uses force against the United States lower than the threshold, the United States has the right, the legal prerogative, to respond proportionately with the use of force in kind. We don't have to wait for a certain level of severity. Harold Coe, as the legal advisor to the State Department, reaffirmed the U.S. position most recently at the U.S. Cybercom conference in 2012, but what he was referring to there is not special to cyber. It's a longstanding position across the board. The second is that the United States and the last two this administration and the one before it, have kind of pushed the envelope on anticipatory self-defense. This is well known from the Iraq War of 2003, the notion of preemptive or preventive self-defense in which the threat is on a long time horizon. But it seems as though even if that, we've turned the corner on that, that extreme line drawing, there's still an instance in which the current administration embraces some aspects of a long time horizon. So if you look at the most recent US military manuals, they'll talk about the last feasible window of opportunity to respond to a long term threat. It doesn't have to be temporally proximate, as in the immediate future. It actually can be, as the Talon manual itself says, a long time off. But if the opportunity is to act now or never to stop that attack, even though it might be 6 months, a year down the line, then that's imminent. That's the US government's position. John Brennan also a year or so ago made a remark that the United States is finding greater receptivity to the idea of long-term threats when we're talking about adversaries who are non-state actors. So it might be the case that the Bush Doctrine has been repudiated in the international community in dealing with state actors like Saddam Hussein in Iraq, but according to John Brennan, there's much more of a receptivity in the international community to long-term threats and a more expansive definition of anticipatory self-defense if we're talking about terrorist actors. So that's the baseline. What I thought I would do with my remarks is talk a little bit about me as an expert in kind of the use of force and the baseline when I come to cyber, some of the questions that I think can be raised. The first is whether or not the US position on lowering the threshold or the kind of tit-for-tat proportionality is more dangerous in the cyber context than it is in physical violence and kinetic force. The idea here is that it's an empirical question, and spirals, and there might be cyber attacks and counterattacks might have a greater susceptibility to spiral out of control. In the generic legal system and attacks and counterattacks with kinetic force, there's a rule that applies, which is that every counterattack and re-attack from one side to the other must be proportionate and necessary. That might be not as easily containable a standard when we're talking about cyber. Cyber has elements in which the attacks and strikes are likely to be more automated, which maybe increases the volatility of the situation. Collateral damage may be less predictable in terms of the consequences of a cyber attack, whether or not it takes out other interconnected systems that were not the primary target of the attack, especially because we're dealing with new technology and it has a very different testing environment. You don't test a bomb the same way that you might be able to test how a cyber attack might go off. There's also much less agreement on what even is the definition of a use of force in cyber. So if adversaries have different definitions, one adversary might think that he's not engaging in a use of force attack, but the other adversary has a different legal standard. That, I think, is also a more dangerous scenario than we have with more settled rules and settled practices out of the cyber context. The last point with respect to the US tit-for-tat position might be more dangerous in the cyber context is the cyber forensic problems. How easy or hard it is to determine what the ex-ante decision maker was thinking when they launched the attack, and to determine who that ex-ante decision maker was. In cyber, it seems as though there are more opportunities for anonymity on the part of the perpetrators of attacks. And it's very difficult, or maybe I would say more difficult, it seems, to determine the intention of the attacker as to whether or not they intended to take out a particular target or have the collateral effects. All of those might lead to different kinds of problems where you'd have to develop a different kind of strategy and a different kind of legal rule. The second concern that I see when I come to cyber that's unfamiliar to me when I look at the generic standards in the laws on the use of force are hackback attacks. So what I'm thinking about here are automated computer systems in which they detect an intrusion. The intrusion is not a use of force. It might just be to gather, monitor, or observe data, not a use of force, but the hackback is an automated retaliation which might launch out to destroy the server systems on the other side. The problem with this is that it does not comport with the international law on the use of force, because you can only respond with the use of force in kind if the initial strike or attack was utilizing the use of force. Now the problem becomes this. It might be the case, empirically speaking, that many states around the world are using hackback. systems. And private companies are using HAPAC systems, which the international law would say some states are responsible for private companies or non-state actors that are within their territory using HAPAC mechanisms. So that opens up a certain kind of a difficult legal question. Maybe the law isn't what we think it is, because state practice is so divergent on this matter. It's an area in which we'd have to anticipate that the law will be more dynamic or change over time. So it's not trying to artificially impress the law upon existing practice. It's actually saying existing practice is so much divergent from the standard law that maybe it doesn't count as a violation, it counts as a new law, a new legal development. The third area that I wanted to pinpoint are rules of state responsibility that relate to the use of force. So my reading of when the International Court of Justice makes a determination as to whether or not a state is responsible for the acts of a non-state actor turns on certain empirical assumptions about the use of force. This came up most clearly in the International Court of Justice's opinion in the United States versus Nicaragua. The question was, is the United States government responsible for all the acts of the Contras that it's funding, arming, and organizing? And the standard that the court applied was a very high threshold of how much control the United States has to exercise over that non-state actor in order to be held responsible for all of its acts. My reading of the opinion is that it's based on an assumption of the prevalence of uses of force, kinetic uses of force by non-state actors. And the judges, I think, wanted a world in which there would be fewer wars, which is not necessarily the right ideal. You might want a war in which there are more humanitarian interventions, for example. But they wanted a war in which there are fewer wars, and therefore raise the threshold. If you lower the threshold and make states responsible for non-state actors, then a bunch of states around the world get to say they're acting in self-defense, and now it legitimates and legalizes their ability to respond. That just might not be the case for cyber. So that it's an empirical question as to whether or not non-state actors' uses of cyber weaponry rises to the level of armed attacks at the same level of prevalence. Is the threat perception the reality? In terms of what the media tells us about the threat of cyber attacks from non-state actors, that would change our calculus. It would also change our calculus in terms of what is an assumption that states have a monopoly on the use of force within their own territory. Almost, I could put on my sociological hat, Weberian notion of the legitimate uses of force. That's not the case with respect to cyber weaponry and the use of cyber attacks, hackback mechanisms, and things like that that are housed within non-state actors and private enterprises. The last point I wanted to raise is about the anticipatory self-defense. The idea here is that in cyber, my understanding from participants in the first Talon manual, there's a pressure to reduce the threshold of what counts as a severe enough attack to legitimate self-defense on the part of victims of armed attacks. That there might be very sound policy reasons for doing that in the cyber world, but that has spillover effects in the non-cyber world if we're developing a unified standard for the use of force. So it's one of the concerns that I always have coming from my world, that what you all develop in your world will necessarily also influence the interpretation and standards that are set. The last is a spillover effect in the reverse, which is a concern that the baseline rules that are developed for other purposes shouldn't necessarily be applied in the cyber context to the same extent. And the best example I have of this is actually the last feasible window of opportunity standard. So on my read, the Talon manual utilizes this language of giving states the right to respond when it's the last feasible window of opportunity to act to ward off what will otherwise be an armed attack in the future. That's somewhat controversial, but I think it's fair. What the Justice Department is developing with respect to targeted killings and kinetic operations, is different. So if you read the Justice Department's white paper on targeted killings, it says something quite different. It says, quote, this applies to a limited window of opportunity within which to strike in a manner that both has a high likelihood of success and then get this part, reduces the probability of American casualties. That's just not the same standard. Withstanding casualties on one side isn't the standard of an armed attack. It has to be that you act within the window to stop an armed attack, not that all states around the world now have the legal prerogative to act within a window in order to reduce the amount of casualties or damage that they might suffer down the line. So those are some of the first kinds of questions I thought I'd open with in my remarks.
So that's a great way to get us started to talk about these kinds of baselines. Then the question is, what rules apply once a conflict is underway? So for those use in bello questions, I want to turn to Gary Brown. Gary Brown is here as a legal advisor to the International Committee of the Red Cross to talk about these issues. Gary also brings a great deal of experience to bear on these issues, having previously served in the United States Air Force as a JAG officer, including as the Judge Advocate General of Cyber Command. Gary.
Thanks, Matt. I probably should start off with this. Everybody I've met here and everybody I meet everywhere else when I go to a cyber event says, what does the Red Cross have to do with cyber warfare? So I'll tell you what the Red Cross has to do with cyber warfare. First of all, I don't work for the blood collection people. That's the American Red Cross, who are great people, but I work for the Swiss, the International Committee of the Red Cross. You may have heard of the Geneva Conventions. We're the ones that sort of put those together. Now the ICRC, one of its roles is to act as a custodian of international humanitarian law. So one of the things that's happening now in cyber warfare is that the rules of warfare are developing. Now, an ICRC has an interest in making sure that the rules are at least the state practice, because states, nations make law in the international community. But the ICRC helps to marshal all those opinions together and push for the development of international law in the spirit of cooperation between nations, et cetera. So cyber warfare is just one more area in which ICRC is interested. And of course, ICRC has a current interest in making sure that civilians are protected as much as possible from the effects of warfare now, even when the rules are very new and just beginning to be developed. Ryan did a great job of laying out a lot of the interesting questions that have to do with whether or not nations resort to war. The sometimes misunderstood concept of international humanitarian law, or IHL, it's often referred to as the law of armed conflict, or LOAC in the United States. I use the terms interchangeably. IHL is the body of law that applies once warfare has begun. So in the context of an armed conflict, these are the rules that apply inside the war. Now, you may not think you have a lot of experience in this, but I know if you read the newspaper, you do have some experience with the IHL, because you've read about proportionality and you've read about civilian casualties and collateral damage and concepts like that. All of those are IHL concepts, and concepts that are incredibly difficult in this context and of great interest to those who practice IHL. Excuse me. I will say it's interesting and common to hear people say IHL applies to cyber warfare. This is in fact U.S. policy, as mentioned in that great speech Harold Koh gave at the Cybercom legal conference. He also declared for the U.S. that IHL applies to cyber warfare. General Frost reflected that again today. And I certainly wouldn't want to put a damper on this enthusiasm for having IHL apply to cyber warfare, but I think it's important to actually look a little bit deeper and see what it means to have cyber warfare governed by IHL. And I'm not sure it means exactly what we would hope that it means. First of all, IHL is this wonderful body of law. Nations love IHL because it's very flexible. And it's almost, you might call IHL sort of the lowest common denominator of law. If we can't agree on anything else, we can all agree IHL applies. And then we'll just argue about the edges and exactly how it applies. But we can agree that it applies somehow. So this becomes even more complicated when you look at it in terms of cyber warfare. And I was part of the team that worked on the Tallinn manual, and during those long meetings, as we discussed some of these topics, we got to find out exactly how complicated it can be to try to figure out how IHL applies to cyber warfare, as we spent hours deciding whether there was such a thing as a cyber blockade, for instance, and what it would mean if there were. And what is cyber occupation? I don't know, but it is referred to in the manual. But all those things are IHL concepts that had to be discussed, because IHL applies to cyber warfare. We did agree on that, and we needed to know exactly how it applied. But it gets even more difficult, because those concepts I mentioned earlier, those ones that everybody's heard of, proportionality, avoidance of collateral casualties, avoidance of civilian targeting, those concepts, the important ones in IHL, generally attach only on attack. So if there isn't an attack inside a pre-existing armed conflict, those concepts don't attach. So can we target civilians in armed conflict? No, that would be a violation of IHL, but targeting means make civilians the object of an attack. So we have to know what a cyber attack is before we can decide whether or not the principle of discrimination applies. It's similarly with the concept of proportionality. How can we weigh disproportionate damage if we're not exactly sure what damage is or how we're going to define damage? So all these terms are important to be defined. Now, how are we going to define a cyber attack? Well, this gets difficult as well. One of the cheap and easy ways to define an attack is to say, oh, well, if you can't decide what an attack is, then it must be what's done with a weapon, right? Because attacks are done with weapons. So let's just define cyber weapon. That's a lot easier.
What?
Yeah, I have no idea what a cyber weapon is. And this has bigger implications in IHL because under the law of armed conflict, weapons, before they can be employed in armed conflict, and under U.S. law as well, weapons have to be reviewed for their compliance with the law of armed conflict. And there are rules inside the Department of Defense that require this to be done, but for the life of me, I really don't understand what it is that's reviewed. Is it 10,000 lines of computer code? And if the code has changed because somebody's patched their system and now it doesn't work anymore, or it's a new version, does it have to be completely reviewed again? Or is it the Dell computer that's used to effectuate the code, or the entire system that's used to put it into place, or maybe it's the internet itself through which the attacks are launched? Maybe that would be reviewed, and that would take care of the whole thing. These are difficult questions, but the bottom line is we can't define attack by the cheap way of saying, well, it's what you do with the weapon. So we have to think of a different way to do it. Generally speaking, the default position for most people has been it's something that's expected to result in civilian injury, death, or the destruction or damage of property. That's essentially what bombs do. So it's a kinetic definition. That's the law as it exists without going out on a limb at all. But most of the things we talk about when we talk about cyber activities, even inside the context of a pre-existing conflict, most of the things don't rise to that level. Most of the things we've been talking about in and out of conflict have revolved around privacy rights, around espionage, and espionage is an ungoverned area of international law, but the U.S. is beginning to want to draw distinctions between different kinds of espionage, good and bad espionage, but be that as it may, no kind of espionage is governed by IHL. Only attacks inside armed conflict are governed by IHL. So if we're trying to protect civilians, what do we want to do? Well, we want to make sure that things can't happen that have a harmful impact on civilian well-being, their ability to feed themselves, to heat their homes, et cetera, communicate, and so on. But inside armed conflict, think of all the things that could be done that would not be damage or destruction inside armed conflict that would have a deleterious effect on the civilian population. What would we do in the United States now if we decided to, somebody decided to manipulate the air traffic control system, not break it, just make it not work very well for 5 minutes every hour. Just once in a while. I wouldn't want to fly. What if all the traffic signals in Los Angeles turned red? Because those are all webbed. They're on the web. What if they all turned red? Nothing's broken. The system's not broken. It's just not working the way we anticipated that would work. What if all the shipping container, the records for all the shipping containers in the port of Baltimore, the port of New York, were just shuffled around? What if all our bank account balances were shuffled around? Money's still there, you just don't know if it's in your account or somebody else's. None of those things rise to the level of an attack. Those are all things that we'd be looking at to protect the civilian population. We'd be looking at trying to prevent those things. So we have to look at potentially redefining the term attack inside cyber warfare. And I would suggest, but I'll leave it at this because it's more fun to suggest than to answer. I would suggest that if we dumb down the term attack and make it at a lower threshold, that we raise the possibility of increasing kinetic responses to events that right now we don't consider to be to rise to that level. So there are problems with that as well, and I'm happy to talk about it more later, but I'll stop there.
Great, well, thanks. Well, so as important as the rules themselves are the institutional arrangements by which these kinds of rules are interpreted and implemented. To kick us off in a discussion of that, let me turn to Herb Lin, who's a chief scientist of the National Research Council of the National Academies, a non-lawyer, to talk a bit about those issues.
I have my cheat sheet here. Also a former hacker. And the usual disclaimer, my views are not those of any institution, but they should be. So I'm going to talk a little bit about command and control here, a little bit dangerous with a military person right in the front row. Just point out that the relationship of offense to defense in this, the empire of the Brits and the Romans were all justified by purely defensive grounds. I wanted to distinguish between offensive capabilities and offensive purposes, and defensive capabilities and defensive purposes. By definition, offensive capabilities are capabilities that are destructive in some sense. They destroy, they damage, all those Ds that you see, and they act on a technological artifact. Defensive capabilities prevent or mitigate all of those Ds. The purpose of use is defined by intent. Okay. What do you want to do? And offensive purposes here are things that adversely affect the interests of the adversary of a decision-making entity. And defensive is when we're the good guys that protects the interests of a political entity. I wanted to look at the world of to bring this to a more familiar level in a kinetic world. So there are offensive purposes and defensive purposes on the top, and offensive capabilities and defensive capabilities on the bottom. And the point of this is that the offensive capability can be both used for offensive purposes and for defensive purposes, right? You can use a ballistic missile to launch a first strike against an adversary. You can also use it to destroy to attack the forces of an attacking nation. Same thing with tanks. Tanks can invade. Bad thing, that's offensive. That's an offensive purpose. But tanks can be used to destroy tanks of an invading army. That's a defensive purpose. But they're the same weapon. Okay. If you look at defenses, people talk about ballistic missile defense. Well, the offensive purpose of a defensive weapon, ballistic missile defense, is to reduce the effectiveness of your adversary's retaliation if you launch a first strike, right? That is, if you're trying to keep the other guy from, if you're held in check by the fear of his retaliation, you launch a first strike, he launches back at you, you can clean up, you can eliminate his first strike, that means you have nothing to fear. And the defensive capability with a defensive purpose, of course, is to reduce the effectiveness of the bad guy's strike. So you can also think about this in terms of some more mundane example, mines. Okay, mines for a defensive purpose, to use defensively, can slow down an adversary invasion. But you can also use mines to blockade a nation, okay, and cut it off from commerce, a distinctly offensive purpose. Okay. So I wanted to point out that in 1953, we saw the following comment which was U.S. national policy. In the event of hostilities, U.S. will consider nuclear weapons to be as available for use as other munitions. And Eisenhower confirmed this in a public speech about 6 months later. Okay, there's the quote. I don't have to read it to you. But basically, he says, I don't see why you wouldn't use nuclear weapons just as you would use a bullet or anything else. Okay, 1954. But he also says an interesting thing later great question that comes whether you get into those areas when you can't make sure you're operating against merely military targets. And that starts to get interesting, and the realization of commingling and so on. And it turns out that, of course, in cyberspace, this commingling is almost total. Okay. So I have to do a quick sidebar about cyber weapons, some realities of it. The first order, every computer in the world is connected to every other computer. Don't bother me about details about how long it takes. The latency is microseconds to months. Okay. But to first order, this is approximately true. If you're going to do highly targeted operations in cyberspace, you have to have lots and lots of intelligence. Lots and lots of intelligence information here. Much, much, much more than you need in sort of ordinary operations. And the third point here is that espionage and attack in cyberspace, you can't really tell the difference if you're the victim. If you're the guy who's perpetrating it, you might be able to because you know your intent. But the other guy doesn't know your intent. And if you tell him what your intent is, he won't believe you. So the understanding and predicting the ultimate effects of a cyber operation are really uncertain. So I hinted at this in my question, somewhat unfair question to the general. I'll acknowledge that publicly. Talk about in offensive capability in cyberspace for offensive purposes and defensive purposes. Okay. So the claim is, you can imagine offensive capabilities being used for offensive purposes. Whoever it was that did Stuxnet had a definite offensive purpose. That party wanted to degrade the Iranian centrifuges used for a nuclear R&D program. Okay. Definitely an offensive act conducted for offensive, for an offensive purpose. A defensive purpose might be, for example, that you launch a cyber attack to take out a botnet controller. Okay, this is the machine that controls a whole bunch of zombie machines out there, and you can go after it and you take it down. And sometimes you even do this with court order. Okay, now there's an interesting. I need anybody who can give me examples on the bottom line that would be really helpful. I couldn't think of the duality there. But to end, that ends the sidebar here. I'm going to talk a little bit about authorities in this context. Today we need national command authority for the use of nuclear weapons and for anti-satellite weapons. Okay? Note, by the way, anti-satellite weapons are non-lethal, right? They don't kill anybody, but it's still a very serious business to launch to take out a satellite. Okay? You need the president to approve it. Today, you need presidential authority, as the general pointed out, for using offensive cyber weapons for any purpose, with perhaps some exceptions for defensive uses under emergency conditions. Okay. What's been released publicly on that is not entirely clear. But I also point out that there are programs underway within the Defense Department to do R&D and procure automated response systems, which will react in seconds, milliseconds, to an adversary attack. Okay. So notice that here when you're talking about, and by offense, by response, I mean in an offensive way. Okay. The spectrum goes from the guy at the top is the only one to do it to the guy to, it's not even a guy at the bottom, right? It's a machine at the bottom. The ultimate in pre-delegation authorities are giving the authority to a machine. Okay. So the full range is contemplated. Now, which one of those actually turns out to be policy? That's an interesting question. Intelligence preparation, then I pointed out earlier that you need a lot of intelligence to prosecute a serious cyber attack. There's guidelines about the president having issued orders to collect targets and intelligence on strategic targets. That's been publicly reported in a variety of newspaper articles. What of tactical targets? This guidance is silent on that. That is scouting out adversary computer systems belonging, for example, to military systems. Nobody knows whose authority is there, at least in the open. We don't know that. Then there's issues of coordination. Okay, within, not only do you have to, you have to do a coordination with three different kinds of entities, within the US government, with the private sector, and with other nations. So let me talk a little bit about this. Within the US government, you need to do this, because otherwise you're faced with the possibility that one part of the US government wants to preserve an adversary cyber asset, for example, because it gets useful intelligence, and another part of it wants to destroy it, because it's causing harm. Lest you think this is fictional, this has actually happened. We had a cyber command attack on a CIA-funded or supported site that the Saudis used, with the joint operation with the Saudis, that was being used to recruit jihadists. The CIA said, we want the intelligence from that to find, because we're getting valuable things. Cyber command, as part of the military, said, no, we don't like this, this is causing harm. And in the end, Cyber Command just took it out. Okay. So you had this very interesting spectacle of one branch of the US government fighting against another one in proxy. Okay. There's technical deconfliction. Sometimes operations that you're conducting may interfere with that one part of the US government is working on, is interfering with government in something else, some other operation. And if you don't coordinate those things, that could be really dangerous, okay, because they might interfere with each other. And then, of course, you have to deal with the fact that the executive branch has to deal with the fact that Congress sits over it, you know, sits over it on oversight. Okay? And you can imagine oversight with covert action. I mean, there's a very extensive process for that, which I don't want to go into here. But you can imagine cyber being used as a tool for covert action as well. What would you do? Then there's coordination with the private sector. If you're going to launch a cyber attack, for example, if you're going to launch a cyber attack over the internet, it's going to have to travel through internet service providers. Some of these internet service providers are American, and are you going to tell them, in the next 10 minutes, there's going to be a cyber attack, don't shut it down? Well, that's not a very good way to approach operational security in this, but, you know, but they could shut it down. Okay. If you're going to launch an attack, is the internet on your side, are your internet service providers, the US internet service provider, is going to be subject to retaliation? Do you want to tell them? You might batten down the hatches because something else is coming. They're going to say why. And then there's, of course, the problems of how do you coordinate this with other nations. They have other cyber operations too. How are you going to and even the question of how you avoid routing attacks through a neutral party, through another nation. It turns out, technically, it's very difficult to guarantee that you avoid country X on the way to attacking country Y. You can't guarantee that. That's hard to do. Is this analogous to bombers getting overflight rights? Or is this more analogous to routing communications? Turns out that under international law, you do have to get permission for bomber overflights, in which case the nation is no longer neutral. But under international law, routing communications, as long as you do it freely, that's not a violation of neutrality. And there is issues of operational coordination here. The NCA is, selects targets, directs the intelligence preparation, but maybe not only by the NCA. Maybe other parties have a role in this too. How do you do this? And then this question about situational awareness. Okay. How do the top leaders of the country know what's happening in cyberspace? This is a really tough problem. Small actions can be misperceived with very large consequences. In the Cold War, there was an instance of during the Cuban Missile Crisis, a U-2 airplane on a routine air sampling mission got lost over the Soviet Union. The Soviets scrambled jet fighters known to be armed with nuclear weapons at the time. The U.S. sent up its own fighters armed with nuclear weapons to defend it. This is in the middle of the Cuban Missile Crisis. Not exactly a recipe for, you know, peace and calm. And that could have been very, very bad. Reconnaissance can be interpreted as a prelude to attack. If you're doing it during crisis, you want to do more intensified intelligence gathering on the adversary to make sure that he's doing he's doing benign things. How is the other side going to perceive your increased perception? How's going to perceive your increased cyber activity in his networks? How will that look? Okay. Reining in temptations. For people who developers of cyber weapons to enhance capabilities. Okay, I am a hacker. Okay, or at least I was, not anymore. Somebody would have to go out of their way to tell me not to include a certain capability. After all, I'm penetrating the system. I might as well include something else, some other gizmo, some other gadget in there that gives it more capabilities. If they find the other guys find it, that could be really threatening to them. Somebody would have to remember to tell me not to do that. Okay. And that's hard. Anyway, that's okay. I'm going to skip over all of this, wrong version of the slides here, but that's the way it goes. Okay, so that's it. And there you go.
Great. Finally, let me turn to Jan Priestelu to give us more of a ground-eye view of some of these challenges. Jan is Director General of the Estonian Information Security Authority, and in light of the Estonian government's experience in dealing with large-scale cyber attacks, can provide us, I think, some interesting perspective on the kind of issues that each of the three first speakers have raised.
Hello. Thank you for this opportunity to speak so big group of the very intelligent people. Thank you for inviting me here. And actually, I'm Director General of Estonian Information System Authority. So beside actually the cyber coordination, we also have the e-government. And I wanted actually to start from my definition of the cyber battle. To me, it's the clash between two collective brains, where targets are the processes inside a society, and battlefield is complexity. But let's start actually what I will talk. I will start from the where Estonia is. It's not superpower in the world like US is. No, we are definitely very tiny. So our population is just 1.3 million people, and if you think about it, then sustainability level of the independent country is somewhere in the region of 600,000. So it's not very far. And we have been very heavily automating our government, and why we do it? Because we are lacking people for everything, including to put them as bureaucrats. So one easy way out of that is to automate their job. And what it means, the other side of the coin is that if point is here that complexity-wise, the administrative functions of the governments are the same. It's not actually depending on their size. And if we fail with it, what it means? We don't have these people to do the same job. In the same time, we have actually a big neighbor who has the scale, who has this the ability to handle the complexity and offer those administrative services, and is doing now it in Crimea. So that's why it's now succeeding in the e-government for us is the national security issue. And about this ID card, this digital signature law. This is with a digital signature, we are saving about 1 week per person per year. And this was the first time actually when we wanted actually collectively as engineers to explain something to the lawyers. And the thing that we wanted to explain was very simple: that beside this astronomic and linear time is also the relative time that has the tree structure. And it took 2 years. But it worked. And why we do it is actually to save the time. So what we're protecting is actually the free time of the people. What people do with their time is up to them. Now we are the democratic society. Now we are protecting the way of life, the quality of the life that people have. And from here, actually, from the selection, there are about 3,000 different services. But here is some selection of it. And laws they are also making in the way that you have this kind of structured way of tracking all the changes in the XML documents throughout the whole process, and it's open. But one interesting thing here is actually e-police. This is the normal policemen under their own name in the social networks and doing the police job. So some people actually ask whether the police whether the cert in the network is the network police. No, it's not. Police is still police. Usually people want to talk about this 2007, and for Estonians, actually this 2007, what happened in the street was totally more awful than what happened in the network. For example, I was living in the center of the city. I couldn't get home because they closed the city. and you have the helicopters flying around, and I don't know whatever actually happening. So it was really bad. And quite clearly, it was the attempt actually to turn over the government, replace it with a government which is it's different than this elected government was. And two remarks about it. No, the people sometimes tell that it's not attributable. It actually is. The same mutual legal assistance treaties. We also have one with Russia. That it's much better than with most of the countries we have. And we filed the legal assistance request. There were concrete names of people living in Russia. And for this time, actually, it didn't work. All other times it works, but not this one. So it's clear that actually the government actually took the responsibility for the actions of the citizen by protecting them. And the other thing, one strange thing also that lawyers can think about it is that I was responsible for the IT security of the bank. So for me actually this activist, there were three of them. This was not sending the long pings of the file, 5 kilobytes actually. Now this is joke. The bad things were botnets, and 40% of the bots were in the US. Because 40% of the internet in this time was in the US. And what changed actually that when we usually send some kind of abuse notice actually to some kind of company in the US, then you're getting back the answer from the lawyer in a couple of weeks actually why this thing cannot be done. But this time actually when we sent actually the lists of the bots, then in 3 hours those things were gone. Something changed totally. I know that some people actually, I have talked with some people actually who made the decisions, and I'm very grateful to them. And what has changed in the conflict was that, or what it changed that it was not shameful talk about to talk in the political level about the cyber attacks. And what else we can see? What else are interesting things that what we didn't count were defacements. Usually people talk about the denial of services. And about the denial of services, why I'm showing this picture is you see actually those two small spikes before that. Those are pilots. So from the cyber, you can, in the cyber world also, you can actually see some early warning things. If you are actually good enough just picking them up, then you can see the things. Whether you are smart enough is another question. And today, I think that we are in the situation that after this Estonia, where the cyber was the side effect, was the Georgia in 2008, where the cyber was quite clearly coordinated with a battle. And before the Arab Spring in Tunisia, there was actually quite similar cyber war what we had in Estonia. Now, why I knew it actually, because I had one student who was Tunisian, and he said that go and see what is happening in the network. So today we are in the situation where all the major conflicts are preceded by the conflict in the cyber. But lessons learned. This was the first. First strategy that we made 2008, it was basically our first strategy was lesson learned out of the 2007. Then we started to account those critical dependencies, looked into the legislation and understood that you have to build the institutions and strong communities. And you have to exercise, you have to build the awareness and also build the international cooperation. And I wanted also to talk about the criticality level. We, in 2010, we estimated also the criticality level of the critical services. And we came to the conclusion that 95% of the critical services are dependent on the IT. And later we discovered that inside this 5% were people who didn't understand the question. then 30% of the services are having critical dependence. It means that if information system supporting it will break, also the service will break. And in 10% of questions, or 10% of the services, we don't have the low tech alternative anymore. So those things are highly critical. If you lose the information systems, you will lose the service. And where it's going, this growing complexity definitely is posing the challenges. And I think that this war will be fought over the managing ability of the complexity. Whether this Pearl Harbor is coming, no, definitely I think that it's coming. It will be some kind of wake-up call for the people who are now talking that the cyber is not serious. A problem with that is that understanding whether the thing is cyber or not is problematic. Now, when I was talking to one American, his family name was White, and he claimed actually that Cyanosuchansk was a cyber event. And he explained also why it's plausible. So your northeast blackout was also started actually from the bad maintenance of the computer, of one software. It wasn't malicious, it wasn't attack, but it started actually for the bad maintenance of the computer. So, and picking up what is accident and what is attack is really hard. And from the other side, you wouldn't want actually in cyber war that your opponent will feel himself just as unlucky. That he is not attacked, but he thinks that all the things that he takes, all the endeavors, for some reason fail. So he doesn't have simply luck. And how we can protect it? No, this kind of way that we will get down the dependence on the IT systems, it will not work. Behind that is our quality of life, and then we would go back the century. So we really don't want that. And now coming back to that this is the clash between the collective brain, so better working collective brain wins. I didn't say bigger, I said better collective brain wins.
Thank you.
Great, well, thank you very much. I'll invite a couple of questions. Let me kick off the discussion, though, in the meantime. I also give you time to think about how to shorten your question into their most pithy form. Let me ask both Gary and Ryan to talk a bit about how some of the questions of legal interpretation, the open questions of legal interpretation, processes by which they're likely to be resolved or whether they're unlikely to be resolved at all. I mean, implicit in your remarks, or explicit in some parts, was this idea that even in the physical space, even in conventional war, many of these legal issues are open to some significant divergence of interpretation. That it's easy to get wide agreement on an idea like states can respond in self-defense to an actionable or imminent attack, but then we have a big debate about what imminence means. Or we can get everybody to agree that attacks must be proportionate to a threat, but then we have a big debate about what's proportionate because we're weighing apples and oranges. Do you see these issues of interpretation as much more problematic in cyber than they are in the physical world? And are they more or less likely to be resolved through international legal processes?
Okay, I'll start then. Sure. Great question, Matt. I think they're a bit more difficult in cyber to solve, probably driven by the fact that there's very little visibility about state practice. So really the law is stunted in this area because much of the law in this area is developed through custom and practice of states. And since states don't put their hand up and own up to actions that they've taken, even though everybody knows some of them, who's behind them, they still don't fess up. That makes it very difficult to develop it through custom and practice. So And then I'll say problem number two is that states are particularly unwilling to give up things that they're good at, of course. And so right now, for the longest time, the U.S. was really, really good at engaging in espionage using cyber techniques. Then it appears, from reading the papers, that the Chinese got really good at industrial espionage, and the U.S. wants to put industrial espionage on the table, but not regular espionage. Of course, the Chinese would probably like to do it the other way around. And nobody's willing to put espionage on the table as one big beast and say, let's all agree not to engage in espionage, and then we can talk about these other issues. Nobody is going to do that. So really, I think the most promising path that we've seen and what I think the U.S. is most driving toward is the development of what they call norms. I'm slightly more hopeful about this than I was 4 years ago, but so maybe it's making some progress, but it's essentially just trying to look at some really basic practices and hope to get some consensus in the international community that these are the best way to do things, and then maybe over the period of years those would calcify somehow into international law, but very, very difficult path and slow.
So the only remarks I might add to that, because I understand those concerns and I've heard them before, is that I'm not so sure that this is so different than other regimes in which states have gotten together to figure out rules that would apply. Will there be rules of the road for weapon systems that haven't yet come online? And we're seeing that, for example, with automated weapon systems, in which they're starting to be at the United Nations, for example, and intergovernmental conversation also with civil society experts, in which states can, in some sense, and governments can think about the hypothetical. So if you can think about the hypothetical future, you might also be able to think about the hypothetical present. To some degree, but I do take the point that it's very difficult to develop customary international law, which is dependent upon two elements. One, what states think the legal obligations are, and two, what state practices are, if we really don't have as much transparency, we're not going to get that transparency around state practice. And then the only other question is whether or not, if there were an interest in having this kind of standard setting at the international level, then we kind of lack those institutions. And we lack those institutions even with just generic use of force, right to go to war type issues. Where would you take that kind of a claim for somebody, not some individual body, but some organized body, to adjudicate or tell us or interpret the law? The International Court of Justice, hears very few cases, few and far between. So we'd have to actually start to develop institutions that can engage in those kinds of conversations or dialogues with states, international bodies, monitoring bodies, or things like that. They don't have any real teeth, but they can at least move along the conversation if the interest is to have uniform ideas or uniform interpretations.
Great, thanks. Herb, you wanted to jump in?
Yeah, one of the things that cyber does is it gives you the opportunity to imagine kinds of damage that you never thought of before. Traditionally, that was death and physical destruction. But let me give you a scenario here. Most of you are voting increasingly on electronic voting machines, and that practice is spreading around the world. Imagine a cyber attack directed against the electronic voting machines of another nation, which results in regime change. So not a shot fired. What do you call that? It's certainly a violation of sovereignty, but does it amount to an armed attack in any sense of the term that we understand? I think the jury's out on that. So there are all kinds of interesting questions in that, with new kinds of harm that can accrue because of the new weapons.
Great. I'll turn to Jan and just invite you to approach the microphone if you have a question. Yeah.
Okay. My first comment is about the loss. If we are looking into the cyber events, then most of the loss is actually the lost opportunity. And if you are throwing it to the court, then this discussion actually whether this opportunity was there or not, actually this will be endless. And the other point is that what the information is in the essence, it is the abstraction of the force. So abstraction of the interaction, data is actually abstracting the interaction, then we are processing it in the abstracted way, in the abstract level, and then we are getting it back to the real world. And actually talking what kind of abstract thought is force is more force than the other force is to me actually complicated thing, and it would result with nothing. In the same time, I think that those CBMs that are built They will not result in the very good results in the near future in the form of the text. But this process is definitely important, that big countries will understand each other, have this process of getting non-understood things into the table and discussing them through.
So, Gary, you spoke about one particular process, which was the Tallinn manual process. Can I ask you to just rewind a little bit and talk about the genesis of that and also what's become of it?
Sure. Mike Schmidt, who's a retired Air Force JAG and is now the head of the International Law Department at the Navy War College, has always been interested in cyber. He wrote his first article, I think, about the law of cyber warfare back in, it was 98 or 99, so a long, long time ago. He's been thinking about this for a long time. He ended up in a variety of academic positions. He was sitting at the University of Durham in England when this process started, but he decided it would be a good idea, having seen the way international law manuals are written and having some experience in the process, he thought it would be nice to take a shot at developing the first law of the war of the law, first manual about the law of cyber warfare. So he got together a group of really eminent legal experts and a few observers. I was one of the observers, not the eminent legal experts. To work on this manual, which really went through, the idea was to take the body of the law of war and apply it as it exists now to cyber warfare. So not to invent new law, not to write what might be or what would be better, but just to take the law and apply it as closely as possible to cyber warfare, which is why we ended up having those conversations about blockade and occupation and all that, because that's the law the way we find it. So. This process culminated in the what's called the Tallinn Manual of the Law of Cyber Warfare, which was published in 2013 by Cambridge University Press, and it's gotten good reviews. I think the main thing is going in, if you look at it, and it is interesting to look, and it's actually a really good walk through all the parts of the law of armed conflict too, if you're just interested in that. And it's a very clear exposition of those, and not too awfully lengthy. Much better than most of the law textbooks. Sorry for all you've written them, probably, out there. But anyway, everybody realizes we were working on it and realized going forward that it really only addresses a tiny sliver of cyber operations. Most of it doesn't rise to the level of warfare, so it doesn't address it. And Mike is now leading a much smaller group on a process they're calling Tallinn 2, very creatively, that's looking at that area of cyber operations that falls below the level of armed conflict. I think it's going well, but I don't have an up-to-the-minute update on that.
Judy Germano, Center on Law and Security. Gary, I'd love to hear more. You mentioned about that we some optimism with regard to the development of norms. Who would create them? How would they be created? What would they be?
Great questions. I think they're just really looking at some very basic things, like if, for instance, the norm of coming to the assistance of other nations. If a nation puts out a call for help because their systems are under attack, that other nations would help them, that the CERT teams, the emergency response teams that each nation has, would not be the subject of cyber offensive activity, so that, because they're just there for defensive purposes and to heal the network, which is in everybody's interest, so they'd be off limits. Things like that, very basic principles. And really there's been a lot of interest, I know, across Europe and North America as far as participating in this and trying to set out these principles. As in so many other areas, the problem comes in when you get down to the nitty-gritty a lot of times, in the actual, I think it's okay to start with those broad concepts, and that's probably where we will start. But as you start to try to lay detail on that, it gets more and more difficult to get agreement, of course, because more people diverge as you go down. And in particular, the last group I was at, there's a group that does a lot of this work up at MIT. It's still up at MIT. And the last one was a lot of the folks from the US, especially the US government, were trying to add, to assert a norm about not stealing industrial information, which is of course not necessarily a norm that's shared by everybody in the world. So, I mean, we might like it here, but that's been the problem with a lot of the norms discussion to date. It's been a lot of people talking about what they wish the world were like instead of people talking about what the world really is like, and maybe just a little bit of edge of moving toward a more positive place. But really, as I've said many times, we actually have a lot of norms in cyber. We just don't like them, because essentially the norm in cyberspace so far has been do whatever you can get away with. I mean, if a norm is what people do, then that's the norm. But we're trying to get away from that, and I think some progress is being made.
Just a quickie add on to that. One of the most interesting things that hasn't been mentioned yet at this conference is that there's a whole array of non-governmental entities and organizations that play a critical role in maintaining the stability and security of the internet. Things like ICANN, the Internet Engineering Task Force, all those things. Not to mention the fact that there are lots and lots of private ISPs around in every nation that are not necessarily controlled by the governments. And it's informal cooperation among these characters that maintains a lot of the stability of the internet that we enjoy. That has been a norm of behavior that has been going on since the days of the internet, since the very, very early days of the internet, and that's actively threatened by government, more heavy-handed government attempts to influence that space.
Any last comments? Otherwise, please join me in thanking our speakers.